So let's first do a little vote. Who you, I assume you're all technical guys, or are there also business people around you that are working with it? Because I tend to do this presentation for a mixed community, because actually the things which is what I talk about here is I need to bring these two communities together, because otherwise it's impossible to have a fair AI. And after this presentation, I hope you understand why I try to do this. So the presentation is quite high level. I try to explain concept and reason about the concept. So I think for technical community, the things will be easy to understand and more, maybe a little bit simple. But it's especially that I do this for my presentation. So as I told you, I also normally have business people in the audience. Let's start begin. Do you have seen this report? It's something from I think 2 weeks ago that the European community issued an ethics guidelines for trustworthy AI, where a lot of experts, one of the IBM, but a lot of other companies were also involved in there. And to give you some guidelines, and these are the seven guidelines that I say, okay, this is what we see from a EU perspective, what we see as trustworthy AI. And a lot of the things I'm going to talk about are in there, like robustness, like governance. I'm not going to talk about governance, but transparency, auditability. This is focusing on social and environment well-being. Now you see that all these things are actually going about people. Now fairness and okay, most of the time you will work with, let's say, dead things like doing predictive maintenance of some machine learning components, but those do not have feelings and those will not sue you. And if you make an error, maybe it costs you money, but that's it. Of course, you're going to start to use AI to score people, to treat people, to let the people do something or deny something, then becomes tricky, because then you're away from the dead world and you're coming to a world of people who have feelings and who have maybe little things, biases, and then everybody wants to treat with respect, I think. And that's where we are today. Now, this is a little bit the agenda, what I will go over. At first, we'll try to explain, but I think you all know this because you're technical community, what the difference between AI, ML, and DL. I will then deep learning. I will then talk about fairness and bias, the difference, and what match brings them together, explainability and robustness. And then I will talk about AI Fairness 360, which is an open source Python library that is open source by IBM, with a lot of fairness metrics and debiasing algorithms. You can use it for free. You can even contribute to that. We also have an implementation where we check bias on our own cloud. It's called What's an Open Scale. I will give you some insight in Fairness 360, and I also mention, I don't want to be too commercial, I'm gonna also talk to you about that open scale, what it does and what it works for putting things into production. So let's first begin, and I assume you all know this. For people outside of the community, they all think that AI is wizardry and it's magic and it can solve everything from world hunger to every war, but that's not the case. In the end, we all know it's mathematics, and it can only do what mathematics can do, and it can't do what mathematics can't do. It's very simple as that. If you keep that in mind, you will understand there are some tricky things if you work with people, with feelings, which is, of course, not a mathematical concept. So at the beginning, as you probably also know, is that you have always two steps in every let's say, model building. The first part is the feature engineering. In this case, you see I've put it in the car and make it simple for business guys. You check which of the things you want to select and to contribute to your model. You say, okay, I have a mirror, I have some tires, I have some lights. And then the second part is the actual building, where the features are combined together, create a model. And this says, okay, if I have two mirrors, four tires, and two front lights and some other stuff, it's a car. But you know, different features can be combined into other objects, like if you only have two tires, you have a motorcycle. But there are the two components that you always have, whatever model you have. You have a feature engineering part, and you have a model building part. And if you look into the difference between AI, ML, and deep learning, it's actually the split between them is who is doing what. If you look at the AI, the initial concept, you have an input and you have an output, and in between you have the two steps. Initially, they were done by humans. So you have a feature selection, and then you put them in some kind of a classification, and we have what we created, a rule-based engine. That's the first thing what you can do. Of course, part of that, of the AI, is machine learning, where we outsourced the classification of the model building to a machine. We say, okay, I still select the features, I click the features, but based on these features, machine, you figure out how to combine them to make your decision. Now, the last wave we had from, let's say, 5 to 10 years now, is the whole thing about deep learning. And what you actually do is now we outsource everything to a machine. We say, this is the input, this is the output, figure it out. Make the features yourself and make the model yourself. Who sees what here is the tricky part? What is here the challenge we have? Yeah.
You don't know what features are being created, you don't Absolutely. Know why it's making a decision.
The whole point is that if you use deep learning, you don't have a clue what the machine is doing. You have no clue what is actually triggered upon and actually how it's created its model and get its output. And if you don't have that in the beginning, like if you do the feature extraction yourself, you do the rule-based, you have to figure that out afterwards, because that's an important part if you start scoring things. Understand what's triggering this thing, and on the other side, how are they combined and giving you the output. Now, the examples I give you are all visual examples, because most people are, it's easier to reason about visual examples. But everything I tell here is also valid for text extraction, name it. Huh? So it's agnostic towards any model. But keep this in mind, I use the visual stuff just to make it more attractive. Knowing that it's mathematics, there's also some two basic concepts that you need to understand. In the end, whether your model is one neuron or 50 billion neurons, in the end, it's a function. It's a mathematical function where you throw something in and something comes out. That's it. Now, two basic concepts that we need to understand before we go further is, if it's not in there, it will not come out. Now, this it may seem obvious, but in the best scenario, you get an answer that does not make any sense. And you know that it does not make any sense and you're not going to make a mistake. But there are situations where something comes out that may make sense, and then you make a mistake, but you don't know it. So that's the first tricky part of the first part. The second one, and that's the classical garbage in, garbage out. If your data has erroneous data, well, the machine will pick it up. And if you feed it, some erroneous data will come out. And that's also, of course, a very tricky thing if you go to fairness. So these are very basic things. So two functions, very simple thing, but you have to keep them in mind when you build your models. So the data is about everything. The next thing is fairness and bias. So you all know, probably you will be biased, you heard about bias. But let's first explain or try to understand what is fairness. And I'm going to ask you a question. I have your picture, and we have the left side and the right side. Who is saying that the left side is fair? Nobody. Who's saying the right side is fair? Well, actually, they're both fair. I can explain them both in a fair way. The first one, I give everybody the same resources. That's fair. The right one, I give everybody the same opportunity. Well, that's also fair. So you see that it's not, there's bias in both of them, but fair is not uniquely defined. And it's a human, there's a human aspect in it. And that's different from bias. The bias is a mathematical thing, which just say there is some kind of a preference for something without being good or bad. Okay, let's do some exercises. You all technical guys, you probably immediately see what's the error here. Let's say I train my data with all these nice cars, and this small car, the yellow one, I score it. Will this work or will it not work? Who says it will work? Who knows why it's not working? You all know there's a bias in the color. Right? I've trained my models in red, and now I put in a yellow one. So the model picked it up and said, okay, a car needs to be red, so it's not a car. But it's a very simple error. Now I'm going to change the pictures. What about this? Technically, this is exactly the same thing. Huh? We have a color, we have an object, the machine picks it up, but we know that the color is not a discriminated feature from the object. Now, why does it feel so differently? The first one feels like a stupid Monday morning error, and this smells like racism. Technically, there's no difference, but the feeling is completely, completely different. Now, you probably know the example. It's real life. Eh? If you look at Google, it was the first one to hit a wall. from technical people throwing something over the wall and say, brilliant play, toy, and then say, yeah, okay, we didn't thought about the impact of it. Now, by the way, I'm not picking on Google here. They fixed it. All visual recognition, including the one of IBM, are biased towards colored people and towards women. So that's the way how the data, how the machine is trained. And IBM did something by provisioning some balanced feature set of human beings of different colors and different genders. But yeah, okay, this the data is like this. And so it's, I'm not picking on anyone here, but they were the first one who actually got hit by this. Now, race is, of course, very tricky. But do you think there are reasons why you could use race as in a fair way? The medical world, people are different, and races are different, our machinery is different. So in this way, is this race biased? Absolutely. But maybe colored people get other medicine than white people, and female get other medicines than male. It's fair, it's biased, but it's fair, and it feels okay. So this is the first thing I want to stress, that there is that the fairness and bias are different things. They are correlated. There's a match between them, but they are not the same thing. It's not because it's biased, it's fair, and vice versa. Because if you look at what we Azure asked you to vote for, there's a bias in both pictures, the top one, the bottom one. And you see, it's always biased in one way. I cannot solve this. If I de-bias the right one, it will become the left one, and vice versa. So de-biasing something is, you will debias towards something. If you look at this one, the first one is biased, is actually discriminating small people because they can't see the match. But of course, the other one is discriminating tall people because they don't get any grades. So this, it's a difficult way of working. And that's also a reason why there are so many fairness metrics. It's not because we love it, that there are a lot of metrics, but all these metrics measure something in a different way. And if you go back to this picture, then you see that when I tell that people need to collaborate, the business side, because they will tell you which of the pictures they see as a fair treatment, depending on what they want to do, about their culture, their feeling, whatever, there is some human factor in it. And then we as a technical community will select a certain bias metric that mathematically can measure the thing that they want to do. For example, if they say, as most of you said, okay, I want the equity one, then I know that I have to check this type of bias. So I will select this bias metric, and I will measure that it is not biased in this way. But by doing this, I, by definition, create a bias here. But okay, that's the choice that the business people, or let's say that the decision takers will have to make. So, and the part is here, we are a technical community. It's not us to say what is fair. It's us to listen to what, let's say, the decision takers see as fair, depending on the situation, depending on the culture. And it's us to do it mathematically, to make it mathematically correct, that we do, that we can give them, and also explain them how it works, and that we can measure these metrics. As you all know, bias is, but since it's in there, it's not because you have trained that it's kept as such. We have something that's called continuous learning. So if you have a beautiful model that actually works, but you keep feeding it erroneous data, like here, again, I'm feeding in red cars, the machine will pick it up again and will become again biased and making bad decisions. And also that some companies have hit the wall, like, for example, the Microsoft chatbot. That one was not racist when it started, but by feeding it, well, correct erroneous data, people triggered it to make it racist. Well, it's once again a technical community had a beautiful toy. They threw it over the wall, and then they forgot that people are weird things, and they want to try this, and they want to let's say it's a challenge it, and that's what's happened here. Another one, for example, is the Facebook and YouTube. Okay, they do recommendations, but also human beings have the tendency to like, maybe weird stuff like accidents or racist movies. Now, it's not because everybody's interested in that you should recommend it. Okay, the machine does what it needs to do. It picks out the most interesting part, and maybe you're interested in it. That may be true, but it's not for a company. They should also be maybe ethical correct and say, look, I know you're interested, but I'm not going to feed it because ethically I cannot feed it to you. So that's the trick where YouTube went into. They put in some recommendations, and they were a little bit off topic for the people who they recommended to it. Oh, the machinery perfectly worked, but they shouldn't have done it. Okay, one of the things that I often hear when we talk about with business guys is say, okay, oh yeah, we don't have the problem because we just don't use gender, or we don't normally capture race, but we don't use gender. That's, we are technical guys, we know what correlation means. And it's not because you drop gender that there is, that cannot be a, that there is not a gender equality. It, even as a name, it's called fairness through an awareness. If, for example, you have occupation in there, and you know, I see here, I see one woman, the other is guys. So in IT, it's a male community. If you go to hospitals, it's a female community. So occupation contains some information about gender. So it's not because I drop gender that the gender inequality is not in there. The only difference is now we don't know it. So the only right way to mitigate this is actually get gender in there and make sure that your model does not use it. It sounds weird, but that's what you actually must do. You must check that it's not using the gender as a decision criteria for your model. Another tricky thing, but that is there, it's just like human being, we have the confirmation bias, that you create a model that's perfectly working. And this is an example where you have a predicting high risk zone, and then you put in more police agents into there. Because you have more police agents, by definition, you detect more crime when compared to other areas. The fact is that it's even triggered as an even more risky crime zone. You put in more agents, you get actually a self-enforcing loop, which is actually not there. It's just the model that enforces itself and decisions we take. It's something that also, as we like community, must learn to our to the business side, that this can happen. It's not because a model does something and you change the environment that the model still works. The model needs to be adapted to the new situation where you're in. So there are two other interesting parts which also come back in the report of the European Union. It's about explainability and robustness. Let's look at this example. I've now get some colored cars, and for some reason, if I put in a turtle, it says it's a car, and when it's not a turtle, it's the yellow Porsche, it seems to be not a car. Who knows what the problem is here? The background. That's indeed the case. The problem is that the model picks the wrong features. And you know, in deep learning, you have no clue which feature it picks. So it can happen. So it's very important when you have this that you validate that the model picks up the correct thing that makes sense. In this case, the background is not an important feature to detect the car. But you need to check that. Otherwise, you're never sure if you use a deep learning algorithm. Probably you know Lime. So this is an example on an example from the Lime paper, where they scored it. I will explain later about how Lime works. They scored the frog tree, tree frog, sorry. And then they checked which of the pixels, because okay, the model only sees pixels, it does not see a frog, are triggering the decision of a tree frog. And then you see that it's actually focusing on the area of the face, which makes sense. So the model picked up the right set of pixels to detect that it's actually a tree frog. Now, if you also look at the errors it makes, the second thing is it defines as a pool table. Also, this makes sense. There are some balls which seem ball-like, and also you see here this heart looks like a balloon. So both the good decision makes sense, but also the bad decisions also make sense. So it seems that the model uses the right pixels and the right triggers to make his decision. So it's a good thing. This is Lime. Lime is one of the algorithms that is used to do that. I don't know if you've heard about Lime. So Lime stands for a local interpretable model agnostic explanations. Let's start with the end. It's an explanation. So it's the important part here, it explains decision. It does not explain a model. So it's looking around the decision. You see the decision is here. It will figure out, it will try to figure out what's happening around this decision. The second thing is model agnostic. It means that it actually works with any model. And the reason that it works is that it's actually tried to figure out by sampling around the decision area, by changing the parameters a little bit, and to figure out what's actually happening around this area. So it doesn't matter which model it is. It just issues, a, for example, an API call and gets the answer back. An important part is also the interpretability. It must be interpretable. And as I go back to the previous slide, we have trained this model using pixels. That's now normally how you train a visual model. But we as human beings are not able to work with pixels. So there are methodology to create some kind of a super pixels. And so define areas, and these are these areas which are actually actually are detected. And the last one, and that's of course what I told you, it's local. So once we have figured out all the samples here, we use a model that is explainable, like for example, linear regression is explainable, an explainable model. And we will use, locally, we will create a linear regression model, and that allows us to explain which features are contributing to this decision and which are not contributing to this decision. And that gives you an idea about what's happening in this area. So this is the example I told you. So when we start with the picture, we create interpretable components. You see, we're not working with the pixels itself, but with areas, some kind of a super pixels. And what we're gonna do, we're gonna blank part of them, and for example, only issue these parts to the model and see what's coming out, for the chance that it's a tree frog. And by combining this, we see that especially the face area is contributing a lot to the fact that we have the scene of a tree frog. The other ones does not seem to have an impact. So it gives you a good idea about, is this model triggered, is being triggered on the correct things or not. Now, for the business guys who have heard about GDPR, everybody I assume, also there is an obligation to explain. If you call your bank and you don't get a loan and you say, okay, why do I not get a loan? And the clerk says, well, the model said so, you're not going to accept that. You want to have an answer. So if you are scored with a deep learning model, they will have to say, look, the amount of money you make is not enough, or your age, or you don't have enough, I don't know what. But they need to give you an explanation. If you can't do that, and even if you go to court and you have to figure out, you have to give some information about how you have to make your decision to defend your case in that case. But GDPR gives you an obligation to do the explanation. You have the right to ask an explanation in whatever model is used to score you. Okay, let's go to the last tricky one. I've here now trained my model with a lot of cars with different backgrounds. Does that seems okay? But now I have a very weird issue. You see there the Fiat 500, and you have two types, the barred one and the normal one. But the main difference is batch. And it seems when the batch changing from a part to Fiat, that my decision changes. You go to yes, it's a car, and no, it's a car. Who knows what the issue is here? It's a robustness problem. A very small change in your parameter, in your input parameter, flips your decision. And if you can understand this by, if this is an intuitive interpretation, if you have your decision boundary, then the line is the model and the curly line is the reality. But the point is, you don't know this reality. The only thing that the model does is try to be an estimation of the real boundary. So by definition, around this boundary, you will make errors, because these yellow parts are errors you will make by using the model, but you don't know them. The farther away you are from this boundary, the more interference can be, the more noise can be in your input parameters, and the decision will not change your, so the decision are much more sound when you're very, very close to this area. Now, normally you say, for example, if you do predictive maintenance and you have this boundary, you can play on the safe side, let's do a maintenance and okay, maybe you make a mistake, but that's not an issue. But if you go to humans, and decision line means you halt your job or you get fired, then it becomes very complicated. Imagine that you get message, you get fired, and you're here. You don't know that. So in this case, you need to have an idea of how robust your model is and where you are, where you around this area, because the decision you will take will have a very big impact on the person that you're giving it to you. So that's a completely different way of doing stuff, of course, than with that material where maybe this is not that that important. Who has heard about the Fusarium attacks? That's Fusarium attacks are ways to trick models into see something that are not there. Now, you can't avoid it. You have a function. It means there's an inverse function, so you can calculate it back. So adversarial attacks are there to stay, and they will be there. The whole point is that you have the robustness is that you can have things that people do not see, whether the model makes the model make a different decision. The example is, for example, if you look here at the picture of a snail, I put in some noise, which is invisible actually for us, and you combine it, we still see a snail. But the model is tricked by this invisible noise for us. It says, okay, it's a mitten. It's the same thing, for example, for sound. If you have speech, you can put in unhearable noise, unhearable frequencies that we don't hear. We are still hearing the same speech, but the model is tricked and will spit out some text that is actually nothing to do in there. This is a nice experiment where they have did the reverse engineering in such a way that it must be acceptable or kind of invisible for people. So they put a stop sign, and they put in some stickers on very strategic places, but it happens. People put stickers on a stop sign. But the model mistook the stop sign for a maximum 45 miles per hour sign. So if you have this and your self-driving car is going to a road and you see a stop sign, but your model sees this, you don't want to happen. Now, if you think this is far-fetched, about 2 months ago, this study came out with the Tesla autopilot. And what they did, 3 small stickers on the road, and the Tesla autopilot thought it has to change lanes and went to the other side. The point is not that you can do this. That's an adversarial attack that can happen. But the point is here that it's invisible for human beings. You have to have a big, weird construction and put it in the middle of the road. Somebody will see it and say, okay, this is weird. What is happening here? But this is something that people do not see. And that's, of course, a very, very tricky part. Now, we are in Leuven. Do you have seen this? It's also an adversarial attack, and I'm not going to downgrade what they did. I find it very, very nice, very, very nice film. And it put it on the attention to the, let's say, the normal community or the outside community. But actually, I find this less tricky than the Tesla issue. And the reason is very simple. The first thing that you see that put this scenario, let's say, in an airport. And you're running around with some picture around your neck. Okay, maybe the cameras will not see you. It's very odd behavior. I'm pretty sure that somebody will say, what are you doing? And if you want something malicious in an airport, you don't want to be picked up by the cameras, but you also do not want to be picked up by human beings. So you want to be invisible, you want to stay under the radar. So the effort that you have to do is much higher than the 3 small stickers that you have with the Tesla, which are invisible. These people will figure it out. Now, also at the end of the movie, you see that he's turning away, and there's a small tilt in the picture, and then it recognizes that's a person. So it actually means that this method only works when you're right in front of a camera. Now put it once again in an airport where you have hundreds of cameras and you want to stay out of every picture, of every frame from those 100 of cameras. It's going to be a hell of a job to do that. So this can happen. This will happen. Adversarial attacks will be there. But I think it's still quite robust for a video. Keeping in mind that by simply using, this is based on the YOLO, I think, use other data sets, and that will not be tricked. So if the moment that you have 2 data sets, it will not work. So for me, this is less tricky than the Tesla one, where people do not see what is happening, and the machinery is tricked into the doing stuff that you don't want. This is, if you a little bit think about more, let's say, of an airport, and you want to detect, this is not an adversarial attack, but it's something that you probably, you as a data scientist, will need to understand. If you say, okay, I want to have a camera surveillance system, and I want to have detect strange behavior and weaponry, and immediately react, there are, if you look at the broad community, we do things, and you probably train your model on that. But there are minorities that act strange when compared to the broad population, but in their way, act perfectly normal. I don't know if you have a younger public, but you know the film Rain Man. It's an autistic person, which is actually very atypical behavior, but for him, it's typical. It's what they do. The same thing for blind people. You know, they are shoveling around with a stick. It's not a weapon, that's what they do. So I call this typical atypical behavior. If you do not train your model to keep this in mind, you will end up with these people lying on the ground with six police agents around them and a gun to their heads. So that's not what you want. That's not how you want to treat these people. And this is, of course, we as a technical community need to train our models. Probably do not have this knowledge. And that's where I come to my main thing, that there is a collaboration needed between the technical community and the business side of things. They understand the business. A few weeks ago, I did the same presentation, and at the end, we were a little bit talking about what people were doing, and one of the data scientists came to me and he said, look, I have a model that based its decision on the nationality of a person. What should I do with it? Now, the first thing is, he feels that it's not correct. And I answered this, well, actually, it's not your problem. You're obliged to tell this to the business side and say, look, my model works perfect, it's accurate, but it takes nationality into account to make your decision. Can we do this from a cultural aspect, from what the business side wants to do, from what the company wants to show to the world? And his answer was, but this person, they don't care about it. It's accurate, it's fine. But then somebody else around there said, yeah, but what does your compliance officer tell us about this? He has other issues. Eh? He's going to get sued when this comes out because it's discrimination. So maybe he says at that moment in time, you have to drop a nationality. And then it's once again, as a technical community, our task to say, to inform them, yes, but I also use people areas where people live. And then maybe they look, what do you say? What is the problem? And then you can explain, you immediately explain the effect of correlation, that you have things like Chinatown and Little Italy, where people live together and have the same nationality. And that based on this, the fact that they live there, give some information about the nationality, and that by simply dropping the nationality, it's not enough to be sure that you're not using it. And this is one of my main messages that I want to give today, is that this is important. We cannot do it together. It's fairness is not a technical problem. It's not our problem alone. It's our problem because we have to explain the mathematical implications, the effect of decision that they take. But at the end decision is at the other side, the business side, the compliance side, the law, people who have to enforce the law inside the company that they do. So we need to help each other to make trustworthy AI. Yeah.
So you don't want to use the nationality in this case.
Yeah.
But we still have some features that are converted to that.
Yeah.
How will we handle it if at the end we want to be completely independent of the machine?
Well, that's the fact of the biasing, and that's you will see later on how we can detect bias and how we can mitigate them. But if what you actually do behind the scenes is that you keep it in and you enforce it, it's actually not using it in your model. But I give you some ideas about how it works. But that's what you do. So you check it. You say, okay, I have a bias, and my model acts upon nationality. I don't want that. I have a protected value. I will protect that value, and then we will the right fairness metric. I will check if this fairness is there or not, and if it's needed, I can de-bias it. So it compensates the tricky things that are in there. But at least then you know that you have done something, because it has a price. And most of the time, if, for example, your accuracy will drop. Because you take out one of the parameters it's using, it's not a given. Eh? It's mathematics do weird things, especially when you have a multitude of neurons. But normally, your nationality, your accuracy will drop. And I'll come back to that in a minute. It has some price that you have also to keep into account. So they give you a little more ideas about how you can do it. We have AI Fairness 360, and it's an open source packet. This is the website from IBM, Trusted AI, and that's all the things we do and also do open source. And you see that we are working on packages that are testing robustness, that are testing fairness, and are testing explainability. And also Lynch, but I don't think there's already a package for that. But the AI Fairness 360 is focusing on this fairness part. And that is a Python library that you can use in your own projects. So what's in there? You will find in there a lot of fairness metrics and also a lot of bias mitigation algorithms. So the metrics, 70. As I told you, there is different definitions of fairness. Which one to use? Well, we have to understand what they do mathematically. Which one to use is what the business will ask. They say, okay, I want this type of fairness. And then it's our task to find a good metric that can check that. And potentially, if we want to mitigate, we can one of the bias mitigation algorithms to correct for the bias that we detect in there. This is an example I will give you a walkthrough in a minute, and then I will go over a few of them. These are the different fairness metrics that are in there. And we also have our different bias mitigation algorithms. And you see that you can work on three levels. You can look at the pre-processing time. Then you actually act on the data itself. I give you an example in the walkthrough. Another one is that you try to force during training, the algorithm to adapt itself so it's not biased anymore. And the last one is a way to, okay, I keep the bias, but in the end, I change the prediction. I use a de-biased prediction rather than adapting this way. They all have their pros and cons, but there are the things we need to learn besides all the machine learning algorithms we have. I think when we won't have a fair AI, especially when we work with humans, I think it's our job to understand these things and so that we can help the business side. As I told you, the fact that you de-bias a model will, by definition, change your model. So you have actually another model. And that can, of course, have an impact on your accuracy and also on the errors you have. And sometimes, as I stated there, the remedies are worse than the disease. And that's also something that we cannot decide ourselves. For example, imagine that you have de-biased your model and your false positives go up. What does this mean? Now, for us, it's a number. We don't care. But the business can evaluate that and say, okay, false positive meaning that I'm serving more irrelevant advertisement to my customers. Is it that? Well, it's probably some annoyance, but okay, I think most companies can live with that. However, if it means that you're issuing more subprime loans and are putting people into misery, maybe you should think about it. Maybe this is even worse than be treated unfair. So this is something that you have to also keep in mind, that by de-biasing, you change your model that can have an impact on your errors, and that can have an impact on people's life. And now for the really technical guys, sometimes it's even impossible to be fair. And this is, as I called, the uncertainty bias. You all know that the uncertainty that you have, the more values you have, the more certain you have your value. So if you have a mean value, the sigma is depending on the size of the sample data. Imagine that you have a majority and minority that you want to protect. And in your majority, of course, the line or the curve is much taller and smaller than the minority. But imagine that you say, okay, I want to give people a loan, but I want to be very, very sure that they want to pay me back. So I have a score, and I want to have at least have a score of minus two. But I'm not going to use the mean value, but I'm going to use the lowest value in my prediction. So I take off, for example, one new. Now, because of the fact that for the majority, if I do this for his value of zero, it's imagine that both have a mean value of zero, I see that if I take one new back, I have a minus two, which is bigger than minus three. So I will allow him the loan. However, a minority person with the same means, but is have a different spread because there are less samples, you see that his mu comes out of minus 4, which is lower than minus 3, and we will not give him a loan. Now this sounds odd, because for us it doesn't feel correct. They both have the same, let's say, score, major score, but because of the mathematical implications and how statistics work, one gets a loan and the other does not get a loan. And you can say, okay, I can correct this and I give them also a loan, but then actually you're discriminating the majority because then they need to have a higher, technically have a higher number to have the same chance to get a loan. So by debiasing at this side, you have bias at that side. And this is something you can't solve. The only thing that you can solve is getting more samples of the minority and get it. This is being a study that you at least need 30%. The 30% minority is minimum 30% that you need to have before this problem does not occur. But the funny part is you can't solve this. This is a mathematical problem and it doesn't feel right, but there's no way to solve this. I don't tell these things to business people because they don't, but I think it's important that we know it is, in the end, it's all mathematics. So it's not wizardry. Okay, let's go now to a walkthrough and I give you also some information about the different algorithms. This is the website. Now for you, if you want to play with it, you have here the tutorials. If you click on the tutorials, you will see that you have, for example, credit scoring, that there are Python notebooks where you can walk through that, give you explanation, give you also some codes on how to use this, how to detect the fairness and how to debias it. But once again, calling 70, calculating 70 fairness metrics is fun and maybe okay, but you will see that some of them will contradict each other, and which one to choose depends on the case, and that's something that you have to talk with your business side, because they will say, I want this, and one of these metrics or multiple of these metrics can be used then to detect this type of fairness that you want. You also have here, if you want direct access to the notebooks and you want to download them, you have here the notebooks in themselves. So if you want to play with it, what I will show you is here the web demo to give you some insight on how it works and how you can, of course, program it. So in this web demo, you have three samples. And you see, the first thing what you see, we call it protected attributes. So if you want to detect bias, you have to explain which of the things you want to protect, what you want to do the bias detection on. Usual suspects are, of course, gender, age, race maybe less because normally we don't store it, but certainly age and gender are typical things you want to protect. And in there, you always have a privileged and unprivileged. One privilege is the group will have always the best outcome. For example, if you look at gender, most of the times it's male, except from recidivism here, the COMPASS, you see that the privileged is female. But most of the time, male will be the privileged one. And the unprivileged is the one you want to protect. The minority, you want to be sure that this minority has the same rights than the privileged one of the majority that you have here. So that's the first thing you have to do. If you know that, let's look, for example, the census income doesn't matter. We have here an example of bias metrics that we check, and there are five of them: statistical parity, equal opportunity, average odds, disparate impact, tie index. There are 70, but these are four. And you can see what's happening. In red, you have the bias. Now, I will explain what these are, so you have a feeling how it is measured. The first thing is the statistical parity difference. It's actually a very, very simple thing. This is the fact that the unprotected group will have an equal opportunity to have a positive outcome. So if you give 30% of the male alone, then you should also give 30% of the female. It's a very simple metric. So it means the difference should be around zero. And we say, okay, with 90%, we can accept some tolerance between 0.1 and minus 0.1. And it's over there. If you have a discrepancy that's more than that, it will give you an error, it will flag it as biased. Then we need to do something. It's the simplest metric that you can think about. The next one, a lot of these metrics, if you look at the paper, for example, work with the confusion matrix. and tries to balance the difference ratios that are in there. The one that is the equal opportunity difference, what it wants to do here, it will give you the unprivileged group the same chance to getting a correct positive score. So this ratio, the true positive ratio, this needs to be between certain limits. That's what you expect. If this type of fairness that you want, that the business side wants, you can use this this metric. Ideal value is of course zero. This is a difference, so zero, and you also here have some kind of a balance. Now the next one that's given in the example, it's the average odds difference. It tries to keep these two ratios, namely the false positive ratio and the true positive ratio, it keeps the same. The privileged and the unprivileged group the same chance of getting a correct positive score and a wrong positive score. It's another type of fairness what you want to implement. And this is what is happening. So this is a rate difference. So the idea is that you get this average of these two odds, that they are around zero with some kind of a tolerance. If you read the paper, there are other metrics that are defined based on the different settings in the confusion matrix. This one. The next one is called desperate impact, and it's actually a group privilege that we want to protect the groups rather than the individuals. You see, that's the algorithm that we use in the open scale. So I will take that slide and explain you how it's done there. Let's say that we have a protected gender, that we have gender, and the majority value is male. It means that male is getting the best outcome. If you look at the gender and see that we have 5,000 samples of a male, 4,000 samples of a female, and 1,000 sample of a gender. How it works is that we actually perturbate the data, so we use the same metrics, except we change, in this case, the gender column, and we flip it around. So you see that the male, we create an equal amount of fake data of female and transgender, and for the minority values, we also create a male equivalent. And then we score our generated score, we see what the outcome is. And then we make the ratios. Let's say that 70% of the male gets alone, and the female 40%, and the transgender 65%. And then in this group bias detection algorithm, we just create the disparate impact, we just create the ratio from these ones. And then you can see that female 40 divided by 70 is 0.457, transgender is 65 divided by 70 is 92. So because we have a threshold, let's say at 80%, we can say that the algorithm is not biased to transgender, but we see that female do get much less an outcome than you could expect if it would be unbiased. So in this case, we say that the group of females is biased against, and we probably need to do something about that in this case. This is how this algorithm works. And the last one, I didn't know that it existed, but it's called the tile index. It's something that seems to be used in economical environments to measure inequalities. And it's, as I understood it, one of the main differences is it's looking at the individuals. And the other one is the group, one is the individuals. It does not, it gives you a ratio, a number, and if it's zero, you have perfect equilibrium, and the higher the number is, the more there is difference between the individuals in your group. This is how it is calculated. This, you see, there is no value here, but you see 0.2, it's not that high. It was, for example, 2 or 3 or whatever, it will be, of course, a lot higher. So as I told you, there are 70 of those measures, all of them with different weightings. There's a lot of papers that are given out or published to create different measures and what the impact is, and it's our job actually to understand those ones that we can choose the right one for the business case that we are working on. So what we see here in this example once again, that we have two metrics who are giving no bias, so the equal opportunity difference and the average up, that's the one that are working on the confusion matrix. But you see the statistical policy just give a bias. It's 0.17, and it must be, of course, less than 0.1. The tile index is not that high, so from that perspective, it seems also very good. But in desperate impact, you see it's not that close to 1. It should be 1. The ratio, it's only 57, so there's certainly a bias if you go to, in this case, race. If you go to the lowest one, the lower one, then you see that if you look at the gender, that we have four metrics that give actually a bias. The Timex is not that high, so probably that's okay. But you see there's a bias, all these metrics give you a bias indication, and probably need to do something about it. So once we've done that, we can try to de-bias it, and then go back to my presentation. So there are different algorithms that I told you. The first one is pre-processing algorithm. What we try to do, we try to shape the input data and create actually a different data set that is unbiased. That's what we try to avoid to do. And in this case, we have two examples, like reweighting. Then we use weights to different tuples, and we try to counteract the biasing. The other one uses a probabilistic transformation, but basically what you create a different data set that is unbiased. Another one is working on a classifier. Probably all know what adversarial networks are. And you have two networks that are working together against each other. And one of the ways you can de-bias is using adversarial de-biasing. You have your neural network, that's the one that you are training. And the other side, you have an adversarial neural network that tries to predict the sensitive attributes. So you feed it in. Based on these labels, it tries to predict the sensitive attributes. As long as it's possible to predict this one, then this one is biased. So this model will try to rechange itself in such a way that this model is not capable anymore to predict these sensitive attributes. And then we have a de-biased neural network. So we have the system adapt itself to counteract the bias in the system. And the last one is actually acting upon the answer. And also it's an algorithm that's used in OpenSkill, so I will explain how it works there. So what we do, imagine that we have a protected attribute of gender again. The majority value is male. Say that we have two scoring endpoints, we have a male and a female. If it's a protected value is a male, we do not de-bias, and we just give you the majority value, we score it, and we give you the answer. If it's a female, internally we use our own neural network to detect if it's biased or no bias. If it's not biased, we give you the outcome of the normal model. However, if it's biased, then we're going to reissue the role. But now, instead using the minority value, we use the majority value, and we give the answer that the majority person would have get instead of the minority value. And that's what we call this case. So we give the minority person the same scoring as if he would be part of the majority version. That's how we implement it in OpenSkill. So what we have is also OpenSkill. I don't know if you know the IBM cloud. We have, but it's also on-premise, by the way. But we have actually a complete set of services. So this is our building service. It's built on IPython notebooks and our studio. It's an open source environment. We have our deployment environment. We have our catalog. This is a governed catalog of all data assets. And then the end side, we have our WhatsApp OpenSkill, which is actually there to monitor the fairness, the explainability, and also help you to manage continuous evolution. So it's part of the service that we offer on our cloud. But it's actually independent. If you look how to position it, if you look at the fairness, what I told you earlier about, it's something that will be used in a design time. You as a data scientist will use these Python libraries to detect the bias and to create a good model. But once in production, that is where OpenSkill comes in. OpenSkill allows you, for example, it also locks the payload. So for auditability, if somebody comes to you and say, I'm being scored, can you explain it to me? Then you can get out the data and launch an explainability model that you can say, okay, you are given this value, and this is based on this and this criteria, and this was for you and this was against you. You also see that it's not only scoring IBM models, but it's also scoring Azure models and AWS models, because it's agnostic. It's just like the line, but you also have an own algorithm that figures out how the decision is influenced by issuing API calls around this decision. So they are
they work together. This is for the for you as data scientists, as developers, as the guys who create the AI. You have to see this more as focusing to the end users, which must be able to explain the system to their end, which must be able. If you look at the payloads, if an auditor comes in, okay, again, what do they have done, and can you explain this kind of decisions? Then they have to go to the payload data, and they can get all this information out. It's more like a production environment, and keeping track on the decisions have been taken about in the AI space. So how does it work? You see that we also that it is actually the same mechanism. They define privileged and unprivileged, and you buy. Majority and minority group. And you can also see that we also give you a debiased end score. There are two endpoints, the endpoint of the normal API and the endpoint of the debiased API. Once again, it is not us to decide which one you want to use. Sometimes the end user will use the normal API, other side it will only give you the debiased endpoint. Now, everything is logged. So in reverse, if you take out the data, you can still see what was happening at the moment that the call was done, and you get both answers inside the database. So I'm going to skip this one. This is the group bias detection we use. I explained that one, and also this one, how we do the debiasing. I explained also that one. And this is the way how you can see it. For example, it's about some drugs and about the blood pressure, and you see it's indicated where the bias is, so you can detect it. You can work, you can try to figure out why this bias is there and how to solve it. And another one, this is the explainability part, where you have your decision, and then you see by the explainability, the company is in this case to subscribe for drug A, and it's especially the blood pressure and the age which was indicating to choose for drug A. And you see the other minor impact, but especially this one, so the blood pressure is a good indication of why somebody got the drug. What you see here, it's some kind of a robustness testing. So it gives you the pertinent negative, the pertinent positive. It's an algorithm from IBM itself. I will try to explain it in the next slide. So what we actually do, we have the mean midpoint, the most frequent endpoints. For example, it's 2. And in this case, we have a salary of 90 to 110. And then we look at the data, the input data point. So the person in this case is scored a 5 and has 150 to 170, so it's here. So how are we going to do the robustness testing? If you look at the first, the pertinent positive, we move the both protected values in the way towards the mean value. And the last value where it's not changing, that's the value you got. So you can move from 5 to 3, and you can move from this one to this one without changing your decision. The other one is the pertinent negative, is we move away from the midpoint and we go away to the first point where it actually changes its decision. So in this case, if you move from 5 to 7 and you move from here to here, you have an approved value. So this gives you an indication on how robust my decision is. Now, once again, this robustness test is something that the business will do. Because if, for example, you can move 1 point, what does this mean? Is this big? Is it small? You don't know, but the business will know. They will know what this number is. So they can decide, is it a robust decision or isn't it a robust decision? And maybe I should investigate if I'm around the edge. So key takeaways, I hope I gave you 3 things to go home. First of all, the difference between fairness and bias, that is that they are related, they are not the same. And looking at the second point, the business side will always work with fairness. They will think about how to be fair. We as a data community will work with bias. But bias and fairness are interrelated. So most of the time, well, how it should work is that that the business service will define how they want to be fair. And our task is to look at the bias metric, bias detection, fairness metric, that can actually mathematically enforce this. And that I think is the only way how to get a fair, or as in the EU report is written, a trustworthy AI. If these communities are working together, they with their technical knowledge, how things work, and this one with the business knowledge and how to treat people based on culture and that kind of stuff. And we always talk about bias, but do not forget, I hope that you understand about explainability, the ability to explain a decision, not only for yourself, being able to say it's triggered by the correct triggers, it's understandable, but also from GDPR reasons that you have to explain your decision to other guys, other people, and robustness, especially when you have a decision that is very impactful for people and you're around the edge, maybe you should consider to investigate manually and to see, okay, this is okay or it's not okay. So if you want to play with it, this is the link to fairness. The tutorials give you the notebooks, give you how to call the Python libraries. If you want to download the notebooks and do it yourself, you can download it from Git. If you want to use OpenScale and you go to this URL, you see here view docs, and then you have two topics. The one is a walkthrough where you give you how to set it up. And the second one is something that automatically setting up an environment for you that you can actually play with the output of it and see what is explainability. And then I always end with a statement I once wrote on the internet. I don't know from who it is anymore, but it's the difference between ethics and compliance, because many people think about compliance. Compliance asks if a company can act in a certain way. It's the legal stuff. But ethics asks whether a company should act in a certain way. It's not because it's legal that you should do it. So that's my end statement here. And I hope I've learned you something.